ladies of Cowboy Church. This is Rebecca Wright. I wanted to let you know we have an event coming. I want you to save the date. November 20th at 5:30, which is a Friday, Mary James will be here. We want to have an impromptu girls' night out, talk about how you're dealing with COVID. We want to know how you're coping or if you are, and just have a nice evening of just fellowship. Please contact me directly for more details, as there will be limited seating, or you can contact the church office. Hope to see you there. Thank you.
Cowboy Church. Sun is up, time's at hand. There's a stir across the land. So begin another day on God's highway. Down city streets, country roads, like a stream of people flow. Spread to win and tolls to pay on God's highway. There is hope with every turn. Bridge to build, bridge to burn. There's hope in you, never goes astray on God's highway. Thank you. Well, good morning. You can do better than that. Come on. Good morning. Way better. So, right now, we already have over 1,600 boxes. And I know for a fact that there's a lot more coming. So, there's no doubt in my mind that we'll reach 2,000 boxes to share God's word to all these people, and these kids are going to love it. Couple things. One, welcome to church. And two, we've been trying to figure out what we can do because of all these things that keep getting canceled and all these things that we are not able to do. And so what I can tell you is this year, the National Finals of Rodeo is coming to Arlington. And so we're going to take everybody to the rodeo. In a sense, we're gonna have on the last 3 days of the rodeo. So I want you to mark your calendar, December 10th, 11th, and 12th. On the last 3 days of the rodeo, we're gonna have a fellowship up here at the church. We're gonna do it on the ranch house porch. We're gonna have an NFR watch party on those 3 days. We're gonna have kids events those 3 days. We're gonna use the arena. We're gonna be outdoors. We're gonna cook some food, hand out packages of food. And so we want to just bring everybody back together and fellowship and enjoy the NFR and just fellowship with one another. Does that sound like a good idea? God made us for fellowship. And I understand that there is an illness out here, and I promise you it's real. And I'm not taking it lightly, and neither is this church. But what I can also tell you is that God intends on us to be with one another. And to be safe with one another. And so we're going to open up and continue going until we're told not to. So just to keep in mind that we are very mindful of you guys and your health. We're also very, very mindful of what God called us to do. Let's have some prayer this morning. Heavenly Father, we just want to come to you this morning, Lord God, and we want to thank you for the opportunity to come together in fellowship. Lord, there are so many places that are not allowed to come together in fellowship. Lord God, we just ask that you just continue to do away with this virus that is causing so much anxiety and so many issues in this country and across the world. Lord, we pray that you would give a hedge of protection over all of your people. And I pray, Lord God, that you would just continue to grow us and get us to a place where we are seeking your face on a daily basis. Lord, I lift up Brother Gary to you this morning. I pray that you would speak to him and speak through him. I lift up our music to you this morning. I pray that it would bring us to a place of worshiping you. And Lord God, we love you and we just praise you today in Jesus' name. Amen.
It's a glad morning when this life is over. I'll fly away to a home on God's celestial shore. I'll fly away, and I'll fly away, oh glory. I'll fly away in the morning when I die. 2,000 years ago, you sent your son. You wanted us to understand that whosoever would believe in him would be safe in His hands. With three rusty nails and an old dogwood tree, the sacrifice was made for you and me. When someone laughs at you, their words can cut you like a knife. Just think of all the shame that you put him through. Yes, he gave more His life, with three rusty nails and an old dogwood tree, the sacrifice was made for you and me. We have a celebrity with us this morning. She's worked very hard for the honor of being, I believe it's, is it Miss? Tell us what it, stand up and tell us what you got there. Yeah. She worked very hard for that, and we're honored to have you with us this morning. Let's go to the Lord in a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord God, we just thank you for this day. Thank you for the beautiful weather outside, Lord God. We thank you for this place where we can come together and worship you and worship the Son. Lord God, we just acknowledge right this moment that you are the King of Kings. And no matter what goes on in this world, that you are in total control, Lord God. We just give you the praise and the glory for everything we have, Lord God. And we love you, and we lift your name in Jesus Christ's name. Amen. I'm pressing on the upward way. New heights I'm gaining every day. Still praying as downward bound. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand by faith on heaven's table, man. A higher plane that I have found. Lord, plant my feet on higher. Has no desire to stay where doubts they rise and fears dismay. Though some may dwell where these abound, my prayer, my aim is higher ground. Lord, lift me. Catch a gleam of glory bright, but still I pray to till heaven I've found. Lord, lead me on to higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand. My faith on heaven's table land. They have said that I have found. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground.
Now approaching lunar sunrise, and for all the people back on Earth, the crew of Apollo 8 has a message that we would like to send to you. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth, and the earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep, and the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters. And God said, let there be light. And there was light. And God saw the light, that it was good. And God divided the light from the darkness.
And God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And the evening and the morning were the first day. And God said, let there be a firmament in the midst of the waters. Let it divide the waters from the waters. And God made the firmament, and divided the waters which were under the firmament from the waters which were above the firmament. And it was so. And God called the firmament heaven, and the evening and the morning were the second day.
God said, let the waters under the heaven be gathered together into one place. And let the dry land appear, and it was so. And God called the dry land earth, and the gathering together of the waters called he seas. God saw that it was good. And from the crew of Apollo 8, we close with good night, good luck, a Merry Christmas, and God bless all of you on the good earth.
It doesn't matter how many times I see that video, it always just touches me to the core. It's very evident that these astronauts, having seen God's creation from a perspective that no human being has ever seen it before, were so moved and so touched by it that what they felt led to share with the entire world at that historic moment was the biblical account of creation from Genesis 1. I want to ask you something this morning. Do you still believe that God created the heavens and the earth? I got to tell you, I still do. And not just because it's in the Bible either. I've never seen the earth coming up over the moon, but I have seen the moon coming up over the earth. I can remember as a young kid one night coming back from the deer lease pretty late that the moon was just coming over the horizon, and sometimes the earth magnifies it somehow, and it looked like it filled the entire eastern sky. And I just remember how remarkable that was and how awed I was by it. I've been to places where they have old growth forest. Maybe some of you have and maybe some of you have not, but I've seen trees literally that if you had the skill with a chainsaw, you could cut up an entrance for my pickup to drive right through the middle of the tree, 10, 12 stories tall, just amazing, awe-inspiring things to see. I've seen thunderstorms blow in across the north plains of Texas. I don't know if there's any other place to really see a thunderstorm. Panhandle may not be good for much, but it's good for that. It's an awe-inspiring thing to see. I remember fishing one morning. The sun had just barely come up and was beginning to light the water around me. And a golden eagle hit the water not 100 feet from me and took off with a 4 or 5 pound fish in its talons. And I just remember being awestruck by that. I believe in creation not just because the Bible says so. I believe in creation because my heart tells me so. Because whenever I see sights like that, there's something within me that just wants to praise or worship or give thanks and tells me that God is there. I also believe in creation because my common sense has always kind of rebelled against it, to be honest with you. The other night, I couldn't sleep, and so as I often do, I get up and I like to turn on space documentaries because I find that, man, that will just put me out. It's almost like NyQuil. If anything's going to put me to sleep, it's that. So I turn on a space show, and on one of these shows, there's a scientist talking about how a team has run gravity simulations through a supercomputer. And they have looked at how gravity has affected the formation of the universe. And what he said, if there was just a smallest fraction of a percentage less gravity than there is, everything would just fly apart and nothing would come together. If there was just a little more gravity than there is, just a fraction of a percent, everything would come together as black holes and be sucked into itself. He said the only way that the universe could exist is as it currently does exist. And then look at the earth. You know, if the earth was just a little bit closer to the sun, or if it rotated just a little slower than it does, this place would probably be a hot mess just like Venus is, and nothing could live on the planet. If the earth was a little bit further away from the sun than it is, it would just be a frozen block of ice. And if life could exist in that, it wouldn't be the kind of complex, beautiful life that we have here today with all of its abundance and different forms, and certainly not with its intelligence. The odds of all of this being random have been calculated. And the odds of it happening randomly are 1 in 10 to the 10th power to the 30th power. I don't even know what that means. That's more zeros than I was never a good math student. I can tell you that's more zeros than I can calculate, and it's more zeros than would have meaning to anyone in this room. But it is a number that is simply virtually impossible. Not only is that so, but for so many decades, we were told that all of life somehow came from a single cell organism somewhere. Now, we don't know how its parts came together, and we don't know how it came to life, and we have not identified the organism, but nevertheless, the theory was that somehow from a simple single cell organism, all of the complicated forms of life in the world have evolved. But what we know today, and this really goes back to the early 90s when people began to look at this and our understanding of microbiology grew, is that even the simplest forms of life on the earth are incredibly complex. The simplest form of life that we know on the planet is an amoeba, and it still has 1,308,759,000 base pairs of DNA in it. Just think about that. Actually, more DNA than we have. Not only that, but it has complex living systems just as we do. And you take one part of it away and the whole creature dies. How did all of that complexity come together? Again, nobody knows. But the odds of it occurring have been calculated, and it is 1 in 10 to the 40,000th power. John MacArthur, who's a very thorough preacher, if you've ever heard him, had a famous sermon on creation in which he talked about all of these things much more in detail than I have this morning. And he said, this. He said to believe that all of this just came together by chance is the moral equivalent of taking the parts of a wristwatch, putting them in your pocket, and walking around until it ticks. He didn't think it was possible. I don't think it's possible. My common sense rebels against it. And very honestly, math is on my side as I think about it. And of course, we do have the testimony of the Scripture as well. The Bible says in Genesis chapter 1, that's what we heard the astronauts reading, Genesis chapter 1, verses 1 through 10. The Bible says that in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. And I believe that. And I think that it aligns very well with what I sense in my spirit and what my common sense tells me. I'm going to tell you something, guys. The Bible, properly interpreted, is never going to lead you astray. It never is. However, I do think it's important for us, if we want to be thinking, mature Christians, to recognize that the Bible has indeed been misinterpreted. All you have to do to see that is turn on channel 2-1. If you've ever turned on channel 2-1, you're going to see some misinterpretation going on. However, in 1610, a man named Galileo invented... Well, he didn't invent. Actually, it was the second. He improved the telescope. And Galileo used the telescope to observe the movement of the stars and the moons and the planets. And very quickly, he deduced that, in fact, the sun was not revolving around the earth as had been believed and taught for many hundreds of years, but that... In fact, the earth was rotating around the sun. Now, the Catholic Church had a problem with this because it had been church dogma for hundreds of years that the earth was the center of the universe. And this was built on Psalm verse 19. And I want you to look at it with me this morning because it does also speak of creation. Maybe it will speak to your heart. Psalm chapter 19, beginning verse 1. It's really a beautiful psalm, by the way. Psalm chapter 19, beginning verse 1. The heavens proclaim the glory of God, and the skies display His craftsmanship. Day after day they continue to speak. Night after night they make Him known. They speak without a sound or a word. Their voice is never heard, yet their message has gone throughout the earth. And their words to all the world. God has made a home in heavens for the sun. It bursts forth like a radiant bridegroom after his wedding. It rejoices like a great athlete eager to run the race. The sun rises at one end of the heavens, and it follows its course to the other end. Nothing can hide from its heat. Now, that sixth verse is very important there. Because they looked at this verse, the Catholic Church did, and this was, again, understand, this was in line with common belief. Everyone believed this. Philosophers, theologians, everyone believed for many, many, many hundreds of years that the earth was at the center of the universe. And the Catholic Church looked at this verse and they said, now listen, it doesn't say here the earth is traveling. It doesn't say the earth is moving. It says the sun is moving. The sun travels across the sky. Therefore, Galileo Galilei, you are wrong. And you will either recant what you believe, or we're going to burn you at the stake. And by the way, just a few years earlier, they had already burnt a man named Bruno, who also postulated that the sun might be the center of the universe. And so he was put under house arrest for the rest of his life. The Catholic Church, always quick to recognize its errors, in 1979 assembled a committee to study the issue, and in 1992 they apologized. 359 years later, but they finally got it right. I'm just telling you this, guys, so you can understand, we can get it wrong. I don't think the Bible gets it wrong, but I think the way we handle the Bible and the way we interpret the Bible can allow us to get it wrong, and we need to be humbled by that and approach it in the right spirit. Now, I'm going to tell you very transparently, I'm different than many of you may be, but even if tomorrow morning I got up and in the news, they somehow found irrefutable evidence that evolution is true, which I don't believe they will. But even if they did, if they dug up a fresh frozen dinosaur and they could get his DNA and they could compare it, and we consider DNA very good evidence, good enough for courtroom, right? And they could absolutely prove that. I'm going to tell you something. It wouldn't move my faith a single centimeter. And I'll tell you why. Because there are still so many problems that science has to answer before we can conclude that God did not create the heavens and the earth. First of all, it still wouldn't get to the root of where life came from. They still have to deal with the complexity of even the cell and the most simple organism. Every one of these organisms has complexity that we can't get to the root of with all of our intelligence and all of our technology. And that problem would still remain. There would also still be the little problem of the origin of the universe. Where did it come from to begin with? Well, science tells us it came from the Big Bang. Well, that's fine and dandy, but what caused the Big Bang? They don't know. And as a matter of fact, by the way, an aside here, science resisted the Big Bang incredibly up until really the late 1900s. Because what they understood was that inherent with accepting the Big Bang, it put them in the same camp as the theologians had been in for centuries. And that is saying that the universe sprang out of nothing in a particular moment in time. And science resisted that conclusion with all of its strength until it was proven beyond a doubt. Furthermore, when it comes right down to it, guys, I am very aware of the nature of Genesis in the Bible. Now, this is a little bit complicated. This whole sermon's complicated, and I hope you can hang with me this morning. But where did Genesis come from? First book of the Bible. You know, we looked at the last book in the Bible, and that was pretty complicated. I'll tell you, Genesis is not no cakewalk either. Where did Genesis come from? Anybody know? Somebody should. Where did it come from? Moses wrote it. It's what we believe. It's what the church has historically taught. There's pretty broad consensus that Moses wrote the Torah. Genesis, the first book of the Torah. It is an amazing piece of literature. If you know anything about ancient literature, there's nothing quite like the book of Genesis. But it is a piece of literature with a specific purpose. It is included in the Bible in order to introduce the people of Israel to their God, to tell them where they came from, who they are, and how they relate to God. And it is filled with a creation account. That's what we just heard. Genesis chapter 1, verses 1 through 10. Actually, it goes all the way through chapter 1. And it's also filled with genealogical history about where various peoples came from and why they live in various areas. Where did Moses get this information? Did God dictate it to him and he sat there and write it all down? He might have. We know that's pretty much how we got the law. He went up on the mountain to be with God. God told him what the law was. Moses wrote it down and he delivered it to the people. We know that's how it happened because Scripture tells us that's how it happened. But it doesn't tell us the totality of how Moses got his various genealogies and his account of creation. And we really don't know. God may have dictated it to him. But Moses also lived in a very advanced culture for his day. He was obviously a very smart and bright person to put the Torah together in the form that we have it. And it could well be that he took some of the best resources that were out there in his time to pull all of these things together, just as Luke did when he wrote the Gospel of Luke in the book of Acts. I don't know if that's how it came together or not. I really don't. But what I do know is this. Genesis was given to the Jewish people so they could rightly understand their origin and how they related to God. That's its purpose for being there. And I also know that Genesis is historically extraordinarily accurate. The people that are mentioned there were real people. The nations were real places. And many of these things we are just now beginning to find archaeological evidence for, but the evidence that we find always supports the Genesis account. Profoundly accurate for its time. It was an ancient creation narrative and history par excellence. And it is by far the best and most accurate document like it that we have ever found. But let me tell you what Genesis is not. Genesis is not a modern scientific textbook. That's not what it is. It's not what it ever was. That's not what it was intended to be. Genesis wasn't given to the Israelite people so that they could calculate the declination of the sun or the phases of the moon. If it was, it would be a lot more technical, but that's not what it is. We need to understand that and not allow ourselves to get so married to a wrong interpretation of Genesis that one day we wake up and turn on the television or pick up our phone and read an article and there's some scientific discovery that just causes our faith to crumble because we've put the wrong spin on Genesis chapter 1. We have to be careful about that. Genesis is a book designed to communicate to ancient people the truth about God and their relationship to Him, and by all means, that truth still applies to us today. Genesis says, God created the heavens and the earth, and I believe that. I accept everything that it says by faith. And I relate to God by faith just as they related to God by faith. But there's one thing that you need to understand. And that is this: whether you embrace the Genesis account of creation or whether you choose to believe in the theories of a random universe, both come down to being a matter of faith. They do. It takes faith to believe the biblical account of creation, but I will also tell you that it takes faith not to believe that. See, I believe the biblical account of creation, but there are a lot of people out there who choose to believe that life and the universe came about by some unknown random process that we have yet to identify. Again, from what this science show that I watched the other night, one scientist said this. He said, "We know there was a big bang, but we don't know what banged, how it banged, or why it banged." There's a lot that they don't know. And there's a lot that they never will know because you can never get in front of the Big Bang. You can't go back beyond that. You can't see what caused that. Maybe it was God who spoke creation into existence. That's what I believe, and it's what the Bible teaches. Maybe it was some random force that we will never be able to see. But either way, you have to have faith to embrace whichever position that you take because you can't know. You can't know. And frankly, the most important question when it comes to these things is not what we believe, but why we believe it. There are a lot of people who do not believe in the creation account, not because they lack evidence, but simply because they don't want to believe in God. There is a quote, by the way, we've just gone through this Bible study, Why I Believe. And I will tell you that there is a complete book. We did not get these for you, but they are available. You can order them on Amazon. It's by Chip Ingram called Why I Believe. It is a easy read. It is full of good information. I highly recommend it. Anyway, in this book, he quotes a professor of philosophy and law at New York University who says, "I speak from experience, being strongly subject to this fear myself. I want atheism to be true, and am made uneasy by the fact that some of the most intelligent and well-informed people I know are religious believers. It isn't just that I don't believe in God and naturally hope that I'm right. It's that I hope there is no God. I don't want there to be a God. I don't want the universe to be like that, and my guess is that this cosmic authority problem is not a rare condition." What's he saying? Let me translate that for you. I don't want to believe in God because I don't want to have a cosmic authority in my life. That's what he's saying. And he goes on to suggest that many other people are in that same place. Well, I think that that's true. There are a lot of people who don't believe in God because they don't want to believe in God. For a lot of reasons. Probably more reasons than I could ever dream up or think. But some people, for example, are unbelievers simply because they're mad. They're angry with God about something. Some of them may be angry because they've gone through something terrible or traumatic in their lives. You know, one of the things that we see continually, and I guess it will continue throughout history, it doesn't just happen in the church, but we hear these horrible, awful stories of people being sexually abused in the church. Can you imagine what that would do to somebody's faith? And so people go through these kinds of traumatic things, and initially they are so angry that God let it happen, and they hold that anger for so long until it kind of becomes just apathy. Until, you know, you can only just be worked up so long. You really can. I mean, your body and your mind can just let you gin up anger for so long, then after a while you got to say, you know what, I just don't even care. I don't even care. I don't even think God even exists. I'm just blowing him off and I'm living my life as if he doesn't. What you're seeing here is people giving up on God. And you have people that don't believe for that reason. You also have people out there who don't believe in God because they love their sin and they don't want to give it up. They want to be the captain of their own ship and do what they want to do. And this whole idea of a random universe is very convenient to them because it enables them, it gives them a philosophy in which they can live their life without their conscience bothering them too much about it. And that is exactly what a lot of drug lords do and white-collar criminals. I'll bet you Bernie Madoff took everybody's money and went to bed and slept like a baby every night. Crooked politicians. I mean, this idea of it being a dog-eat-dog universe and its survival of the fittest, it empowers a lot of people to go out and do what they want to do without being too troubled by their conscience. And there's a lot of people that don't believe in God for that reason. But guys, here's the deal. Deep down, in their heart of hearts, don't you think they know? I mean, the Bible says that they do. I want you to look at Romans chapter 1 with me for a second. Romans chapter 1. And we're not going to read this whole passage. But in Romans chapter 1, we're told that God has given us enough information for us to have insight about these things. Romans chapter 1, beginning at verse 18, says, God shows his anger from heaven against all sinful, wicked people who suppress the truth. It's not that they don't know the truth. They do know it. They suppress it by their wickedness. They know the truth about God because he has made it obvious to them. For ever since the world was created, people have seen the earth and sky, and through everything God made, they can clearly see his invisible qualities, his eternal power and divine nature, so they have no excuse for not knowing God. Yes, they know God, but they wouldn't worship him as God or even give thanks, and they begin to think up foolish ideas of what God was like, and as a result, their minds became dark and confused. Claiming to be wise, they instead became utter fools, and instead of worshiping the glorious, ever-living God, they worshiped idols made to look like mere people, birds, animals, and reptiles. And I'm just going to stop right there. This was written about false religion in Paul's day. Paul looked at all the idolatry that was going on around him, and he said, really, people are without excuse because God gives us more sense than that. Just like what I described my experiences a while ago, when I see a majestic mountain or I see an eagle, you know, sailing down into the water, all of those sorts of things that awe me, I often wonder what atheists do with that. Because that energy causes me to want to cry out and thank and worship God. And so Paul's saying this was true in his day as well, that people are out without excuse. And so what this tells us is that at some point in time, everybody has an inkling within their heart that God created the world. They know through their own spirit
and the testimony of their own hearts that God is there, but they don't want to believe. So what do? They harden their hearts, and they turn to some other philosophy. Now, in Paul's day, that philosophy was idolatry. Idolatry was everywhere, and you could find a God that would enable you to do what you basically wanted to do. In our day, idolatry is not an issue, at least not in the West. In our day, it is the random theory that the universe just kind of happened. But guys, it is probably causing us to suffer every bit as much as they would have suffered back then. Make no mistake, God will ultimately hold all of us accountable for what we believe, because he has given us plenty of reason to believe in him. We have all been touched by his creation. Most of us have been exposed to the power of God's word. Many of us have experienced the presence of God's Spirit in our life. So if we choose not to believe, it's not because of lack of evidence. It's because we don't want to. And that's what we have to get to the bottom of. But I will tell you, brothers and sisters, that as long as there is life, there is hope. And so if you are hearing this sermon this morning and it's got your head spinning and you're wondering what to do because you have doubted God for a long time, I would simply tell you, God can help you. God can help you. As long as there is life, there is hope. All you need to do is ask God to help you change your heart. Help you to desire to believe. John chapter 6, verse 37, Jesus says, "Whoever comes to me, I will never drive away." In Matthew chapter 7, verse 7, Jesus says, "Ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and the door will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives, and the one who seeks finds, and to the one who knocks, the door will be opened to you." If you want God, he's going to be there for you. If you don't want God, he's not going to be there for you. And if you're one of these people who say, "Well, I just have never found any evidence of God," you might want to look it within your heart, because it's very possible that in your heart of hearts you don't want to believe. But make no mistake about it. Whatever it is that you're basing your life on, whether it's God or something else, it is a faith proposition. And if the Bible is true, and I believe that it is, God's going to hold every one of us account for that ultimate choice that we make. Amen? Let's go, Lord, in a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning in Jesus' name, praising you and thanking you, Heavenly Father, for your word, thanking you for your Spirit, thanking you for the good earth. Lord, the beautiful place that you have prepared just for us to live, the miraculous place, a place like none other exists that we have ever found. A place that is so glorious that it just causes us to want to turn our hearts and our spirits to you in praise and worship. And Father, we thank you for your word that confirms what we even feel and sense in our hearts. And what I pray this morning, Lord, is that you have driven these things deep into us. That, Father God, we will freely and gladly embrace the idea that you have in fact created this earth. Father God, you began it, and you will be the one who brings it to its close, and each and every one of us will stand accountable before you. Lord, if there's someone here this morning that you're working on in a particular way, I pray that you will help them. I pray that you will go to them by your Spirit, that you will reveal yourself to them. I pray, Father God, you will draw them to your word. I pray you will draw them to your knees, and I pray that you will confirm, Father God, your promise that you are always there for those who diligently and earnestly seek you. Lord, I lift all of that to you this morning in Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen. Guys, thank you so much for being here this morning. Hope that you have a good week. Do remember that if you have not been able to give to Operation Christmas Child, you still have a little time to do that online. There's a link up on Facebook, and we would love for you to participate in that way if you haven't been able to do so otherwise. With that, we will see you next week. God bless.